Reading from John chapter 16, which you'll find on page 1084, if you've got a pew Bible. Now I'm going to him who sent me, yet none of you asks me, where are you going? Because I have said these things, you are filled with grief. But I tell you the truth, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. In regard to sin, because men do not believe in me. In regard to righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And in regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I've much more to say to you, more than you can bear, but when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will bring glory to me by taking from what is mine and making it known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will take from what is mine and make it known to you.
Thank you very much, Paul. And do we turn to God in prayer? Thank you that we're in those better days that Jesus spoke of, when the Spirit is with us. And may we each this morning hear you, Holy Spirit, speaking to us, encouraging us, revealing Jesus to us. Amen. Well, I don't know whether you ever find speaking of Jesus or communicating the gospel to your friends in this society a bit of a challenge. You could almost call it mission impossible. Does it ever feel like that? A skeptical, cynical society. And you may even have those moments when you think, well, it was okay for those first century Christians. They had it easy. But oh, today it's tough. I just thought I'd remind you of the situation for those first century Christians. They were largely trying to communicate the gospel to Jews. And the Jewish people were looking for a king like King David. Powerful in battle. Big guy, or impressive guy. Powerful. They were looking for a Messiah. And then Jesus turns up. A poor peasant who is cursed by being crucified. And the followers of Jesus had to say that anybody who did not know Jesus and linked their life with Jesus was considered to be unclean. Can you imagine how difficult that message was for a Jew? Can you imagine? Not easy. Mission impossible, you might say. Well, there were the Greeks as well. The Greeks were others that the gospel was going out to. And the Greeks were largely following Plato and Aristotle, who believed that truth and beauty was something in the immaterial realm or the spiritual realm. And then Jesus comes along and says, by the way, truth is embodied in me, a human being. Not easy for a Greek to take in that. You might say, mission impossible. It gets slightly worse. I hope I don't depress you too much on Pentecost Sunday. But it got slightly worse because this mission they had to spread the good news of Jesus happened, and Jesus is in our passage just about preparing them for it, at the moment when Jesus was going to disappear. So it's like your team leader disappears just when you're sent out. Mission impossible or what? Well, I hope I'm not depressing you too much, because our text says it's not impossible. Verse 7. Why is it not impossible? But I tell you the truth. It is for your good that I am going away, because unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. You see, whilst Jesus was around, it was great news for the people hanging around Jesus, wasn't it? Now, if he'd sort of stayed around and we could have appointments, it would be a little bit like a handshake with the Queen. Possibly we might get it once in our entire life. Yeah? But he said, look, that's no good. It's not going to work because this kingdom is for everybody. And so I need a force, a power that's going to communicate me, Jesus, to everyone. And that is the work of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit takes the presence and power of Jesus and personalizes it to every man, woman, and child who is seeking. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. And that's why it's not mission impossible. It is if it's down to us. But if the presence of Jesus, if the presence of Jesus by his Spirit is being applied unseen to each person who is hungry and open to God and hearing the gospel, this is not mission impossible. This is mission utterly possible. Not because of you and me, but because of the work of the Spirit. And I want you to focus in this text on verse 8. We're going to spend quite a lot of time on this particular verse. It says, when he comes, the Holy Spirit, and we've read already that he has come in Acts chapter 2, when he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. And then he unpacks that in verses 9, 10, and 11. What does it mean about sin? What does it mean about righteousness? What does it mean about judgment? And we're going to look at those three things together. So let's start off with this statement that the Holy Spirit will convict the world with regard to sin. Now, this doesn't sound a terribly appealing line of argument, does it? You know, I've got some good news. I'd like you to be convicted of sin. But this is the work of the Spirit. Now, what do we mean by this? Well, as I look around, and as I was going for my walk down the Chess Valley this morning, and I saw the beauty all around me, the Holy Spirit can speak to people and can say, it's God's world. This is God's world. And many people look at the world and they say, it's mine, and I can exploit it as much as I like. But when the Holy Spirit comes, he communicates to people, you're living in somebody else's domain. It's God's world. And you've been living as a rebel, imagining that you could do whatever you like in this place. Then it belonged to you, and you had a little bit of real estate that was yours. And the Holy Spirit can say, no, that's not the way it is. And you may say, well, what's that got to do with sin, Malcolm? Well, sin, basically, at its root, is a unilateral declaration of independence. It's where a human being says, I'm going to do it my way. I'm going to live my life the way I want to live my life. I'm going to have no recourse to a creator, no recourse to God, no recourse to the presence of God in my life. A UDI, I'm going to be independent. And that is the source, the root of sin. And then the outworking of that we see in various ways, which we'll come on to a little bit later. If you like, the Holy Spirit is a bit like a mayday call on a cruise liner. If you think about the Titanic, it had lots of soft furnishings and beautiful stuff, yeah? And it all looked good, even after they hit the iceberg. But under the water, the whole hull was compromised, and the ship was going down. And whether people played beautiful songs, had lovely wine, they were in need of being saved. They were in need of God, or somebody coming to help them. And that's the work of the Holy Spirit, which is, it's like a klaxon call saying, you carry on just as you are in UDI, unilateral declaration of I'm going to do it my way, and you're in a very, very dangerous territory. It may not look like it, but the Holy Spirit can reveal this is dangerous. You need to watch out and respond. And the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth about our lives. Now, I want you to just imagine for a moment that you're going down to London tomorrow on the Underground. So you go down to Chorley Wood or Little Chalfont or wherever, and you get on the train, you have a nice day, you come back, and this hot weather has brought thunderstorms, okay? And as you come into Chorley Wood Station, you were planning to walk home, you come into Chorley Wood Station, the heavens open! And you go, oh my word, you know, I was going to walk home, but if I walk home, I'm going to get absolutely drenched. And you suddenly think, I know what, I need a taxi, yeah? And you're thinking, in very godly thoughts, I hope I can get to the taxi rank first, maybe. But anyway, that you weren't expecting that you needed a taxi at all. But the rain has come, and you now know you need help. Yeah? This is the work of the Spirit. In a similar way, when the Spirit comes, things that we just didn't realize were important, didn't realize we had a need, suddenly we get it. We need help. We need saving. This is the work of the Holy Spirit, and we can't do it ourselves. I don't know whether you think back. I'm amazed, actually, when I have conversations with people. A lot of the time, you know, people kind of go, well, you know, I don't really need God. I don't really understand it all. I don't think he's yet spoken to me. And then I'll go down, you know, say 6 months later, and somebody say, well, actually, you know, I'm starting to pray, and I'm open to God. And you think, oh, that's interesting. You know, they thought they didn't even do anything. And then 6 months later, they're saying, you know, oh, do you know, I'm feeling... You know, feeling the need of God. And you're like, what's happened? What's been going on? And then you actually look yourself and you think, I think back to myself and I'm thinking, well, a lot of the time I was like, no thank you, no thank you. And then you suddenly, there was a baptism service for me, suddenly I'm like, I need Jesus. I came down the front, I responded and I'm thinking, what's going on? Well, I did make a decision to do it, but it was God's Holy Spirit was at work. Suddenly I realized I wasn't on my own. There was a God that I could relate to and that I needed him. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. Isn't it great news that the Holy Spirit is at work? Don't you think? Yeah. It's encouraging you. I know I said mission impossible at the beginning, but this is what makes it possible. Yeah? Don't think it's all about you. It's about the work of the Spirit working through you, yes, but it's his work. We need to be depending upon him working. Verse 9 sort of builds on this a little. It sort of unpacks what this conviction of sin's about. It says, in regard to sin, because men do not believe in me. This is this unilateral declaration of independence. I'm just going to live my life as if God wasn't there. And that's, of course, what Eve and Adam did in the Garden of Eden. We know he said something, but we're not going to listen to him, you know. Talk to the hand, the face ain't listening, like last week. And if you look at the serpent, he wants to make a big name for himself. He wants people following him. Doesn't want any recourse to the living God. Because men don't believe in Jesus. And of course, the fruits of this independent life pushing God away are kind of obvious, really. If there is no God, if there is no eternity, if there is no heaven, then surely it's all about getting as many goodies this side of death and to enjoy them. And isn't that what we see really within our society and also we find affecting our own hearts, and we have to protect our heart from that. Whereas what does Jesus say? Build up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy. So if we say, well, I have no recourse to God, then don't be surprised if our lives are filled with many and muchness and things and worrying about not, you know, all sorts of issues which are not important. Also, the fruit of sin leads to unfaithfulness in relationships. If we disconnect ourselves from a faithful God, don't be surprised if we become unfaithful ourselves in various ways. The fruit of sin is also where we choose to call the shots in society, in our family, in our business, in our little neighbourhood. We want to be on the throne. We want to be in charge, giving no space for the presence and the power of God to be with us. You see, the work of the Holy Spirit is to show us that sin is deeper than we ever imagined. And when we find the Holy Spirit working in our hearts and lives, we stop protesting our innocence. We stop saying, I'm a very nice person, really. I'm a very good person. We stop saying that because we say, well, you know, I was living in rebellion to God. The fruit of that was a life of money, sex and power in various combinations. It was deeper than I ever imagined. It had a hold on me and the ship was going down. I needed saving. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. When people understand that, take it in. And the strange thing is, sometimes I hear people say, well, Malcolm, you know, you're not talking about sin, are you? Oh, that's very, it makes me feel guilty. It makes me feel shameful. Well, my experience of when I recognize that I have sinned, when I recognize that I've done wrong, is that when I come to God and I say, look, I'm sorry. It's not a whole load of guilt and shame. Far from it. I don't know how you find it. When I come to God and confess my sins, it's like a weight off my shoulder. And I suddenly know that he loves me anyway. I'm amazed. But while I go away and I'm hiding away and I'm saying I'm a very good person, don't criticize me, anybody, I'm in the dark. I'm not in the light. Can you see that? So I don't understand when people talking about sin is kind of a negative thing. It's not for the Christian, because it brings it out into the light, and then he can do his transforming work, the power of the cross, to forgive and heal and restore. Verse 10. Not only conviction that our sin is deeper than we ever thought possible, but verse 10, in regard to righteousness, because I am going to the Father where you can see me no longer. Jesus is lifted to the very throne of God, higher than we could ever imagine. I want you to imagine for a moment, there's a boy in a school, and he's had a moment of madness, or you could say of great excitement, and he grabbed the fire extinguisher, and he totally soaked his class. Are you thinking naughty, or are you thinking how funny? I'm not quite sure. Anyway, we meet the boy in front of the head's office. He's about to go in to see the head teacher. And we ask him, did you do it? Did you do it? And he says, I don't know yet. And you think, what's he going? Oh, he's working out whether he can bluff it with the head. Can you see? Oh, it went off in my hand, sir. Or somebody else did it. Or, yeah. Well, he might. We don't know how it's going to turn out in the head's office. He might get away with it with the head, mightn't he? He might. But how foolish we would think that we might be able to bluff it with God. I mean, do you remember the story of the Samaritan woman? And Jesus is having a nice chat with her at the well. I think we were looking at this the other week. And he says, call your husband. She goes, oh, I don't have a husband. And Jesus says, you're absolutely right, you don't have a husband. In fact, you've had five, and the current man you're with is not your husband either. Oh. He knows, and he's righteous. You can't bluff it with Jesus, with God. Or how about Peter, you know, that sturdy character, suddenly sees something of who Jesus is. He goes, depart from me, I'm a sinful man. You can't bluff it with God. He is more righteous than we will ever imagine. Higher, his righteousness is higher than we ever imagined. Now, I'm told that in 1505, I wasn't there at the time, Martin Luther is recorded to have hated God because God was so righteous. That's where he started. He was really annoyed with God. He's just so righteous, higher than I could ever attain. Until he got stuck into the book of Romans, which for many of us is quite hard to get stuck into the book of Romans. But Romans 1 verse 17 says, that righteousness that can be yours and mine comes from faith in God. So our sin is deeper than we ever thought. His righteousness is higher than we could ever imagine. And we go, there seems to be a problem here. Mind the gap. Yeah? And as Luther found, but hold on. The righteousness that comes is from faith in God. So we put our faith and trust in God, and suddenly it's like an escalator. Oh, welcome. This is a treat. Good to see you guys. We'll chat to you over coffee. Fantastic. We've got the sin being deeper than we ever imagined and the righteousness being higher than we ever imagined. And we then say, well, how do we bridge this gap? The text says through faith in God. And we know that Jesus fills that gap, doesn't he? He bridges that gap. The Holy Spirit is the one who reveals to us that our sin is deeper, God's righteousness is higher, and then takes us to Jesus. That's what the work of the Holy Spirit is. But just before we get to Jesus, because it's a good place to finish, and our text finishes there, verse 11 says, "And regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned." Now the text talks about the prince of this world. That is Satan, the one who sort of decided he wanted in the spiritual realm. He wanted to do it his way, and he turned his hand against God. But the passage here says he stands already condemned. It's as if the prince of this world, Satan, has got terminal cancer. He's currently alive and kicking, but his destiny is utterly certain. He is to be destroyed. I don't know whether you've ever had these moments, but in my teenage years, I realized that my eternal destiny really did matter. And I kind of was in that position where I hadn't yet decided that I wanted to follow Jesus or not. And at the time, it sort of seemed like a safe thing to sort of hedge your bets, you know? And then when I realized that our eternal destiny was at stake, and if we just do nothing, we're going the way of the prince of this world, I realized that I was in deep need of being saved from that destruction, from what is facing the prince of this world. And it suddenly made me realize that sitting on the fence no longer seemed a wise thing to do, but an extremely foolish thing to do, and a very dangerous place to remain. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. He shows us that actually doing nothing, sitting on the fence, is not a tenable position. I've been spending some time in recent weeks with some of the older folk in this church, some of whom are really not very well. As you know, Lynn is in hospital in Watford. She's had her hip done. Her right leg is very badly infected. She now has a chest infection. They're not quite sure what it is. They're trying to work out whether it's bacterial or virus, so do pray for her. But when I asked her, I said, what would you like me to pray for, Lynn? And it's not just Lynn who's said this, but other older members of this congregation have said this. They said, would you pray for my children and my grandchildren? Incidentally, they're not asking that they pray, that I pray that they get good GCSE results or A-level results or a very nice degree or a good job, although all those things are good. No, they're asking me to pray for the eternal destinies of their children and their grandchildren. That's what they're asking for. Maybe when we get close to meeting our Maker, everything's put in its right place. Yeah? And we start praying for the important things, the things that really matter. And so, can I encourage you, as they've asked me to pray, could you pray for those that we know are currently walking in UDI, Unilateral Declaration of Independence? I'm doing it my way. And we pray, don't just pray with your own strength. Pray and call upon the Holy Spirit to do his work of convicting of sin and righteousness and judgment. You see, the Holy Spirit convicts that our sin is deeper, God's righteousness is higher, and that judgment is closer than any of us imagine. The Holy Spirit, please rain down and do your work, which we cannot possibly do, of interpreting this to those who currently do not hear. Now, the final focus is a lovely focus to our text, verse 14. It says, "He will bring," this is "He, the Holy Spirit, will bring glory to me, Jesus, by taking from what is mine and making it known to you." He, the Holy Spirit, will bring glory to Jesus by taking what is mine and making it known to you. So on this Pentecost Sunday, if we're to do Pentecost right, what we want to do is to have the right focus. The right focus for what the Holy Spirit would want, yes? And so if we're going to do Pentecost right, the focus should be on Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit's always pointing to Jesus Christ. Kind of strange, really, isn't it? You know, normally if you had a Pentecost Sunday, you think, oh, let's focus upon the Holy Spirit. And we have thought about the Holy Spirit. But the work of the Holy Spirit is always to point to Jesus Christ and to his work that he wants to do. We've just seen that the Holy Spirit reveals that our sin is deeper than we ever imagined, that God's righteousness is higher than we ever thought possible, and the judgment is closer than we imagined. So is it any wonder that the Holy Spirit points us to Jesus? He's the one who can bring somebody who's in the depth of sin and link them, connect them with the beauty and holiness of God, the righteous God, and can make that one righteous, holy, because of Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? So he brings us to Jesus. He brings us on Pentecost Sunday and says, look, stop this unilateral declaration of independence. Come to Christ. Put your trust in him. For too long, you have not surrendered to Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life, says John elsewhere. For too long, we've stayed away. Receive his free gift of forgiveness. And as he suffers on the cross, as he bears all the judgment that we deserved, we say thank you. I need what you have done. I need what you have paid for. And as his robes are stripped from him, he clothes us with his robes of righteousness. Amazing, isn't it? Stunning. Remarkable. May the Holy Spirit interpret this afresh to each one of us. We may have heard it before. And perhaps just a prayer to finish. Holy Spirit, thank you for doing what we couldn't do for ourselves. Truly, you have revealed the truth about ourselves. We don't want to hide. Don't want to pretend that we're very nice people. Thank you. Thank you that you don't reveal the truth of the depth of sin just to leave us there, because you want to pour out your mercy, your forgiveness, and your very life into us. Thank you that you've revealed to us the truth about the beautiful holiness and righteousness of God. And that although you seem slow to come and sort out a fallen world, truly your judgment will come one day. So powerful, loving, transforming Saviour, be my Saviour, be our Saviour. Ask him today. Come in today, come in to stay, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. May it be a home for your Spirit. Save me from sin. Make us holy. And we pray that as we go from this place, the water will get deeper and deeper. And your Spirit will do that lovely work with those that we speak to and talk to, that we meet, even without our involvement at all. And you will convict of sin and righteousness and judgment. We worship you. Thank you for your utterly possible mission by the power of the Spirit. Amen.